born and raised in Lynchburg, Virginia, March the 25th, 1924.
And were you brought up in town or outside town? Or?
I was brought up mostly in town, but sometimes in small towns close by Lynchburg.
Talk about being a kid in that era, in the 20s and the 30s, and you know what you did for fun in the summers and how you occupied your time as a kid in that era.
Well, most of the time there was a lake up the road. We used to go up there and swim. Called it Slagle's Lake, and this was in Emporia, Virginia. It was a small town. My father was a foundryman, and of course it was during the Depression, and we went where he could find work, you know. And we went swimming most every day, and we, there was a watermelon patch on the other side of the creek that we used to go help ourselves, the farmer's watermelons, and bring them back across. I was only about 8 or 9 years old, but I could swim, and I'd bring the watermelon back. We'd bust them open on a rock and help ourselves. And,
So other than liberating watermelons, you swimming and those kinds of things, was it largely an outdoor type of childhood?
Yes. Yes, for the most part. I had six brothers and sisters, not necessarily at home all the time, because as soon as they got big enough to leave home, they left home, you know.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Oh, yes.
How so?
Well, you go from doing reasonably well, you know, in your lifestyle to having very little and sometimes almost nothing, you know. I can't ever remember being hungry or not having clothes or things like that, but we didn't live a life of luxury either.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
Sometimes. If it was a subject that I liked, I would put some effort into it.
When you walk into a classroom full of kids, you have the full spectrum of personalities, a quiet kid, loud kid, joker kid, you know. If we walked into your classroom, which kid were you?
Kind of withdrawn.
You were kind of a quiet kid?
Well, not necessarily quiet. I was quiet, maybe momentarily, but I would open up to you after I got to know you, you know, after I figured out what type of a personality you had, you know.
You know, it was the Depression. It was difficult times, but you know, that now, when you look back on your childhood, did you like your childhood?
All in all, I would say, for the most part, yes. There were times that, you know, things weren't too cozy, but for the most part, I would say yes.
And why do you feel like that? Because it was hard times.
Well, when you get used to living the lifestyle that we got used to living, it wasn't necessarily the best lifestyle in the world. People that we had, well, most of my friends were in the same boat that we were in, you know, and I probably, see, most of the kids did, I was poor, and I knew I was poor. They were poor, but they didn't know that, you know, they didn't know they were poor.
What was your situation when Pearl Harbor was bombed? Do you remember when that happened?
Remember. I was on the doorstep, practically. Let me see. It was in 1941, December 7th. I was 16 years old, all right at 17 years old. And as a matter of fact, right after that, I kind of hung around, stayed in school for a while, and almost graduated and didn't, and went into the military right after my 18th birthday. And well, I took care of that later on. You know.
Well, tell me the story then of getting into the Army Air Corps.
Well, you know, they weren't taking all that many people into the Air Corps because the Air Corps was not real new, but fairly new. And they were taking people in. They gave us, during our basic, we took a series of exams when we went to induction and to see what we were suited for. And I took a radio operator, armorer, that was the guy that loaded the bombs on the plane, pilot, bombardier, navigator, whatever, and to see what you were suited for. And they figured that I was suited to be a radio operator. So they sent me up to Madison, Wisconsin. And this was happened, and that was after I finished my basic training. That was a couple of 3 months, and a couple of months, and then I was up there 4.5 months. And then, what do you do when you become a radio operator? If you're not a ground radio operator, you must be a flying operator, okay? Well, that sounded exciting enough. Little did I know, you know, that can be hazardous to your health.
And the training, did you have to learn Morse code?
Oh, yes.
Was it difficult? Or?
Not for me, it wasn't. I was very good at it, if I must say so.
So you went through the training to become a radio operator. Where'd it go from there then?
Well, we went up to Salt Lake City, Utah, and got in a pool of people, you know, like myself. And we were dispersed out. Well, for me, I went to Moses Lake, Washington State. At Moses Lake, I met the rest of nine members, the rest of the crew members, nine of us, and we'd never laid eyes on each other before. I was, I think, the youngest man on the crew, and my pilot was, I think he was 21. Old men, you know. Well, our co-pilot had been in the service for a while, and he was the oldest man on the crew. He was 23 or 24, I forgot
which. Who was your pilot?
Julian G. McAfee from Johnson City, Tennessee. Because we called him Mac. They called everybody McAfee, Mac. You know, they did then.
Talk about the, was there some crew training? Were you all trained together?
Yes. See, we were all, at Moses Lake, we were sent to that area to join our crews so we could go into what they call three phases of training. We learned to fly in formation, and that can also be hazardous to your health because you run into each other when you get up there, you know. But Mac was an extremely good pilot, just great.
He was a natural.
Oh, yeah, he was, and he had the temperament, you know, to be a pilot.
And what is the temperament to be a pilot?
Well, he was conscientious for one thing, and very bright. Very bright for another thing. And he had this intuition about things, you know.
Was he calm under fire?
Indeed he was. Indeed he was. Not so with some of the others, but I mean, and not at first, but you learn. You learn it as you go along, you know. You know, you try not to, even though you're afraid. You don't want to admit it. You can't quit. So you got to make the best out of it. And that's probably what we did. And
I'm sorry. I was going to say in the training part, when you all came together, did everybody get along? I mean, it coalesced pretty well?
Oh, no. We fought like cats and dogs. Well, we had one of the armorers is a boy from Oklahoma. The boy had the highest IQ, and he looked like riffraff. I'm going to tell you, As a matter of fact, when we got ready to go overseas, this guy, the captain that was processing our papers for us to get ready to get our stuff together to fly overseas, they picked up his papers. And he was standing by me. This guy's name was Bloxham. And he said, "Is Leon Bloxham here?" Bloxham just kind of raised his hand. The captain didn't say anything. He just said, "I just wondered what somebody looked like that had 165 IQ. He was so smart, but he didn't look at, you know, if you'd see him, you would not take him to have that. And he wasn't all that well educated, but he was oil well smart. And I think he turned that into some stuff later on, some green stuff, money, you know. And I might be wrong, but I think he is the only one besides me that's left in our crew.
Well, you went through that crew training together, got used to each other.
Yeah.
And where to go from there then?
Well, during the first training, you fly. The ball turret gunner gets down into the ball turret. The top turret gunner gets into the top turret. The radio operator operates the radio. Everybody does their job. And we do that for a while. And you do it daily. I mean, you go up almost every day if the weather permits you to go up. And the second phase of training, we get more aircraft into the formation and stay pretty far apart. If the guy gets his wing into your waist, you know he's reared too far. He's reared too far. He's got to back off. And we lost people too, I think.
During the training?
Yes. Not a lot, but some. And it was strictly due to not really paying attention and not going by the rules and regulations that you're supposed to go by, because you're not supposed to get all that close at first. But you learn. So you're going to fly close formation. And they tell you when you go into the Air Force, "I don't care how well you know how to fly, or if you can fly. We don't care about that. But if you're going to fly for us, you're going to fly the way we want you to fly, and that's it. And you don't veer off from that either. You fly the way they want you to fly." By the time we got through with that, everybody knew his job, and everybody flew the way they were supposed to fly. You know?
And that's a good point. Give me a job description of a radio operator on a B-17.
Well, I'm going to tell you about my job description didn't last long. There are two of everything on a B-17. There are two radio operators, there are two armorers, there are two pilots. The bombardier and navigator are cross-trained for the most part. They can do each other's jobs. There were four officers on the crew and six enlisted men. A boy from Ohio named Dean Davis was trained as a radio operator too. And Dean wanted the job. And you know, it didn't bother me a whole lot, but you know, radio operator carries another rank, another stripe. They carry tech sergeant's rank. And we were all staff sergeants at that time, because we hadn't decided who was going to get which job, because we could all do it equally as well, I thought, you know. Nevertheless, I let him have the job, and he was a nice guy. I mean, he was kind of a mama's boy, you know, and he stuck pretty close to the pilot. He kind of looked, that was 2 years difference between him and the pilot. The pilot had turned 22 by that time.
So where did you end up then?
I ended up flying a waist gun.
And did your plane have two waist gunners?
Yes.
It did.
Yeah.
Because, of course, later in the war, they went to one waist gunner.
You know, I believe you're right, but I heard that later on, but not back then, because as we needed all the firepower on that aircraft that we could get together. And everybody was very, very busy from the time almost that we crossed the English Channel until the time we came back. And sometimes they followed you home, you know, and shooting at you.
Talk about that journey over. That's a lot of water to go over. What do you remember about that journey?
I remember, number one, that you don't fly over the North Sea. Because if you happen to go down in the North Sea, that's it. You don't ever show up again. And that's the route we flew. But as I said, my pilot was very careful, and we made it. And we landed in a little place called Nuts Corner, Ireland. It was not too far from Belfast, and we all jumped out of the plane. We'd been in that thing for 13 hours, I think, and we went into Belfast, and we went into this gin mill, this pub, and somebody was blowing a whistle down, and kind of the fight broke out. Now, we hadn't been there more than 30 minutes, and the whole place started to fight. We got involved briefly. Mac wouldn't have been in there to start with. Said, let's get out of here, right quick. So we did. We retreated and left them to their fight and went on back to our plane, and they found a place for us to sleep. And
when you landed in Ireland, now, how did you get down to Framlingham?
Took the airplane and flew it down.
Ah. Did you go over with the original group, or were you a replacement?
Right after them.
Okay.
Right after them. It wasn't but a couple of 3 weeks. But they had to go through the same thing we went through insofar as training, because you have to go to different places, you know. It's a place called Bath that we went down. The whole crew had to go to these places because everybody had to know what we needed to know about that particular aspect of the flying part of it, you know.
When you got to Framlingham, to the 390th, what did it look like? What was the base like? What was it like when you got there?
A big mud hole, to tell you the truth. Rained all the time. Rained all the time. But that three flags, they put up on a pole, you know. And the red flag meant that you were flying then that night, so be prepared. They were going to wake you up about 2 o'clock in the morning, and you were going to go to briefing and to breakfast, and you're going to take off about 5 o'clock, and you're going to hit a target somewhere in Germany about 8:30 or 9 o'clock, and try to make your way back if you were successful in hitting the target. It was a lot of stuff that went on with you, but you see, we had to be in a hurry because we lost a lot of aircraft, a lot of aircraft. I don't really know how many we lost in that. Yes, I do know how many we lost in that group, but I don't know whether they would want me to say so or not, because it's not good for the morale. The only thing I can identify that with is I went over to the office to have my insurance plan adjusted. And a little captain, he wasn't over 22 or 23 years old, he looked at me and he said, I'm not supposed to be telling you this, but is there any way that you can get out of this? I said, I don't want to get out of this. I didn't think I did. But 2 weeks later, I wanted to get out of it. That's who it was. Because it's a little different when you're speculating about what will happen and then what actually happens. You
know? What happened in the next 2 weeks?
We started flying. Number one, we were getting pretty heavy penetration into Germany with no fighter planes, you know. It's pretty much of a comfort to look out there and see those little P-51s and P-47s and all that, wiggling their wings at you to let you know we're friendly and we came to protect you and to guide you to the target and to take you home. Except they couldn't go all the way home because they didn't carry enough gas. We carried 2,800 gallons and we could get to the target and get back if they didn't get you before you got back. Sometimes what they would do, they were much, much faster than we were, so they would go back to the base and refuel and catch up with us and go back, go to the target, almost to the target. They figured out better ways to protect us, you know.
Do you remember in that 2 weeks what, especially those first few missions, that must have been the wake-up call on what it was like?
I remember the second mission very well.
Tell us the story of the second mission.
Okay. We were had just hit the target, and I felt something into my leg, you know. We were flying at 26,000 feet, you know, and we had our heated suits on, and that piece of flak hit me. It hit me right here, right in the buttocks, and it just felt hot, you know. And old Bloxham got on the intercom and called McAfee. Said, "McAfee, I believe Stevens has been hit. He's laying in the floor." And it's him.
He put that IQ to use, did he?
Well, as it happened, it wasn't all that serious, but it was bad enough, you know. So they nursed me along, and we got back to the base, and they took me to the hot. What happens is, if you have somebody that's wounded on the plane, you shoot a red flare. The co-pilot sticks his armor to it, shoots a red flare, and that gives you landing privileges first. And we landed, and of course, all the bells and whistles and all came up to our aircraft at the dispersal area, and they took me out on a stretch. I probably could have walked, I don't know, but I tell you, it's kind of frightful, you know, to know that you are hit and you don't really know how bad you're hit. You know, I knew I was bleeding pretty good, but I wasn't bleeding so bad that they didn't take me to the hospital and patch me up, and I flew the next day. Now, it wasn't all that bad, as I said, and I couldn't tell how bad the wound was because it was patched up. It never gave me a lot of trouble. It earned me a Purple Heart, you know, but I wasn't embarrassed to take it, you know. It was a whole lot worse than some of them, but I wasn't really proud of it, you know. And I was the only one on the crew, I think, on my crew, that got a Purple Heart. My bombardier got a piece of shrapnel that came through the plexiglass dome in the front, you know. The bombardier flies the plane across the target, and he got a little piece. It hit him in the forehead, but right here, came through, smashed the plexiglass in front. But it didn't stick in there. But he bled. He took his fingers and rubbed it off. There again, the bombardier probably helped save my life, because when I got hit, because the cord in my heated suit broke, shorted out, you know. And you know how long it takes you to freeze at 26,000 feet? Not very long, just a matter of a few seconds, and you know, you're out of here. But he came back, and now his compartment is heated. So he traded heated suits with me, and we went on a very our business. And I got patched up, and I'm not going to say everything turned out swell, but it was fine, because all's well that ends well. And
how many missions did you fly?
25.
You're not going to remember all 25 missions, and you certainly described a pretty memorable mission there. Were there other missions for one reason or another that stuck in your mind?
Well, Ray, there's a story in every man that ever flew combat. Little things, you know. You're looking out your window, you're shooting somebody, and over here you see a B-17 going down, you know. This happens almost all the time. You see a fighter shooting down a German plane over here on this side. You're supposed to keep this in your head now, so when you get back to interrogation, they can ask you questions. And you're supposed to have this photographic memory, you know, that you can just bring that all back. Well, to start with, there's an old saying, and if you don't think we were scared, you ask our laundry lady, she'll tell you. You know. I shouldn't have said that.
But it's true.
And of course it's true.
How did you, what was it about you, your background, who you were, whatever, that allowed you to deal with the fear and to continue on? Because not everybody did.
You got to, number one, keep telling yourself that you're here. Well, and I didn't finish the sentence. You're here because you're not all there, for one thing, you know. They'll tell you that, too. But it's a cohesive thing. The crew just melds together. They take up for each other, you know, and they go out together. And it's a little unique. It's not like the infantry or the Navy, you know. The officers don't fraternize with the enlisted men, but we were pretty cozy, you know. And it's a different breed, is what it is. Now, right now, at the reunions, you know, do you know Lieutenant Colonel Pennybaker? Colonel Pennybaker was the first lieutenant when we went over there. He was about 5'5", weighed about 130 pounds, soaking wet. I flew two missions with him. He was command pilot. That means we led the entire 8th Air Force in their little plane from Framlingham, but they had the right man doing it.
Why was he the right man?
Because I was told, now, to start with, he was a Harvard graduate. He was 3 or 4 years older than the rest of us. And but you talk about a guy, and the first mission I flew with him, he had just been promoted to captain. And it wasn't more than 2 months later that we flew the second mission with him. He'd already been promoted to major. And then, not long after that, to lieutenant colonel. I don't know whether he ever got promoted in after that or not. But he was in headquarters, and he was a very, very bright guy. And we came back from a mission one night, and we were talking about this 100th Bomb Group. Mac was flying co-pilot, and our co-pilot was flying tail gunner. That sounds strange, but it was true.
Who was the pilot?
McAfee. No.
Pennybaker was the pilot.
Mac was co-pilot, and Mac was equally as good a pilot, I think, as Pennybaker, but I don't think he was as experienced as Pennybaker. Because Pennybaker, he got over there with the very first bunch, and he went to work with headquarters, and he was kind of used as a spare pilot. You know, not a spare pilot, but some when they really needed somebody with of his caliber, with his experience, to do something. And another thing, he was no nonsense, strictly. Not around us, but he may have been, you know, when he got to the officers' club that night, but I never saw him display anything other than just being the rigid guy that he was. And
so what happened on this mission?
Well,
you're memorable.
As we started back across the English Channel, we lost an engine. I said, well, you can fly on three, you know, fly on three pretty good. Well, we got about halfway across the English Channel and lost another one. Now it's getting sticky. And Mac called up and said, okay, get rid of the stuff. Throw it everything you can. I mean, you throw it everything. And get in the radio room and prepare for either ditching or crash landing when we get to the other side of the English Channel. That Pennybaker nursed that thing all the way across the English Channel. That thing was spitting and sputting, and we were wheezing back there, you know. Nobody wants to land in that English Channel if they haven't, you know. But if we have to do it, you have to do it. And another thing, youth has something to do with how angry you get, how mad you get, or how scared you get, too, for that matter. And the first thing you know, I heard the landing gears go down. This was about 10 or 15 minutes after that, because it was not far across the channel. And that rascal sat that thing down at the 100th Bomb Group, which is only 12 miles from the 390. at the 100th, and the 100th, that particular day, it wasn't unusual for them to lose half of their planes. You probably heard that.
So you got back safely.
Yeah.
Two engines.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes it gets down to one, but you better make arrangements to get out of there, you know. And as I said, if your training is good and you know what to do, most of the time, you can come out pretty good. It's kind of sad to look out across the horizon there and see B-17s circling and going down over here, circling going down over there. And sometimes they're to your squadron, you know, they go down and you're still there. And you wonder about that, and somebody's watching out for you, you know.
Is that the feeling you had?
Well, I had that, you know. We get down and kiss the ground and cuss and all that stuff, and then go on about our merry way and forget about it until the next time. But and if they ask you, you know, had it to do over again, would you do the same thing? I've asked myself that, I don't know how many times, Ray, and that would be a decision. If it was based on what I was thinking back then, I'd be here there. But that's the way it is, though, with most of us, I think.
Did you get leave where you could go into London?
They sent us to the rest home. They said we were flak happy after 18th mission. Sent us all up to a nice rest home up there.
What happened up there? What was that like?
Well, we had horses to ride and civilian clothes to wear and whiskey to drink. What are you talking about? Yeah, just like downtown. They really put on a dog with food and everything. This world was a little bit better than what we'd been used to. And we were up there for 2 weeks. Well, a couple of us on the way home, though, we stopped by London. And we got ourselves in a little bit of a hassle. I did, and so did one of the other guys. Lieutenant Colonel Ray Armstrong was our squadron commander, and he wasn't the sweetest guy in the world, especially if you bent the rules. But after we had finished our missions, I'm going to go up a couple of months, you know. I got the first sergeant came in to Colonel Armstrong, wanted to see me in his office. And I wondered, what in the world he wants with me? I haven't spoken to him but twice since we've been here. Oh, I went and saluted him. And he said, sit down, Stephen. And I'm sitting on needles and pins because I'm looking for the worst. I've got a delinquency report on you and a couple other guys here from London. I said, Colonel Armstrong, that was 2 or 3 months ago. He said, I know. I needed you then. I don't need you now. You're talking about hurting a guy. He said, get the hell out of here. That's what he said. Get out of here. Well, no, he softened up. He didn't really care, but he just wondered. He was only about 25 himself, you know. He said, I was told that you might want to go to cadets when you get back. I can arrange that for you, you know. I said, well, after being here, I just used that phrase, after being here for several months, I don't really know whether I want to go to cadets. Well, that was, well, they tried twice, once there and once after I got back. I was at Langley Field, and they came around recruiting radio operators to get on B-29s to go to the Third Pacific because the war wasn't over, you know. And I respectfully refused, you know, because things were still pretty hot down there. But anyhow, it's stuff like this, it happens daily to me or somebody else that you know, or somebody else that you fly with.
When you were flying your missions, especially near the end, were you kind of doing a countdown of the missions?
You ain't just Whistling Dixie, man. I'm telling you. You count down. Most all of the crews, some of the guys on the crews drank whiskey. You know what you paid for a bottle of gin? Was mostly gin and scotch. And I didn't care for either one of them, but you know, I like beer, even back then. When we landed, McAfee and one of the other officers went down to the pub and bought the only two bottles. They were only allowed two bottles of booze a day. I mean, for all of the throng that used to go in there, but they had plenty of beer. And bought the scotch and the gin and had it there. And when that B-17 touched down on the 25th, he broke that out, you know. We waited until after we'd gone through. We just had itchy feet to just get through with the interrogation because they had to call us in and question us about what we saw and what we didn't see and did you see this or did you do that. That took an hour. And you there again, you know, you'd have to tell them as accurately as you could because nobody could ever get it real straight. And some of you saw the same things and some of you didn't see it. But after the interrogation was over, Mac called us and we went over there and we got into that booze. but it wasn't enough, you know, for all of us to get bonkers on. But I tell you what you do. All of you faithfully get down on your knees and you kiss the ground. And that's what we did.
Was there any point in those 25 missions where you didn't think you were going to make it?
Oh, every one of them almost. Not all of them now, because, you know, once in a while you get what we call a milk run. And that was, he hit a little. Well, what we thought was a milk run actually wasn't a milk run because we were softening up. Particle A, France, you know, and Particle A was right there where D-Day took place, you know. And we'd go over there and we'd see things. Most of it was camouflage stuff, and we were flying only at about 2,000 feet because it was close to the coast and they didn't have any German fighters up to get us, you know, so we just take that time and bomb it, but it was all camouflage. And we said, Max said, they're nuts. Wonder what they're doing this for. But there was a method to their madness. You know, we would turn down the stuff that they were building up because somewhere along the line, we feel that General Eisenhower and General Montgomery or whoever was manning the ground troops for Great Britain knew about what time that D-Day was coming. And this was way before D-Day. But we were softening them up. Every time they put something up, we'd knock it down, you know. They didn't send every crew over there. They didn't send not even more than a couple of three groups, you know, just to get rid of what they put up. I never didn't know really what it was, and I don't think Mac did either, but you get rid of it because you think that they had things that could shoot all the way across the English Channel. And then, you know, they had the buzz bombs.
Did you ever see any of the buzz bombs?
Oh,
What did it look like? What did you see?
It looked like a long bomb flying on its own, and they were laying pretty close. Let me tell you, they were accurate. The Germans were expert munitions people.
When you would see the buzz bombs, what did they sound like? What did they look like?
It had an eerie sound. You knew what it was, you know, by the sound of it.
How often in a mission was, you know, were there a few missions you used the guns, or how often would that happen?
Every time you took off in that airplane, you got them ready when you were going over the English Channel. And you'd fire maybe 100 rounds every day there in the water to make sure that everything was right and it wouldn't freeze up and stuff.
Were there missions you had to use the guns against fighters?
Oh, yeah. If you're asking me how many, almost all of them. Two-thirds maybe more than that. I can't tell you.
What's a fighter look like when it's out there? And
well, they had sayings, you know, in the German Air Force, just like we had in our Air Force, you know, beware of the Hun and the Sun. You know, the Germans and those Mu-109s, get up into the sun when you were going to the target, you know, and it's almost impossible to see them. They'd blind you, you know, and they'd come in 6 or 8 abreast and just come right down through your squadron and take airplanes with them when they went most of the time, you know.
Did anyone on your crew ever get any credit for knocking down a fighter?
Well, they got what we call a probable. You know, when you got 3 or 4 guys shooting at the same plane, everybody's going to claim it. I would, so would everybody else. I'm getting my fair share of the glory. So you get, it's labeled a probable. He got 3 fighters and a probable. We had some were pretty good. And that blocks them. That I was telling you, he was accurate. Came back home on the Ile-de-France, which was a beat-up French luxury liner. And the food on that thing was absolutely terrible. I met some people on there, though. I was the only one from my crew that went home on that. They don't necessarily send you all together back home, you know. Some of us flew, a lot of them flew back. But then again, I flew over and a lot of them didn't fly over. They took a boat over. You get there in a hurry, you know, when you're flying. I think it took us 8 or 9 days because they had to use this maneuvering tactic they call. Every 70 miles or whatever, they change courses with the ship to keep submarines from getting on your trail. I don't know whether that helped or not, but I never heard of any of them getting shot.
So what was it like to get back to the U.S.?
Well, let me see, where'd I go? Oh, I know. The Ile-de-France parked, were docked outside of, on the Hudson River, north of Fort Meade, Maryland. And that's where we got off and took small craft down to Fort Meade. There again, we had to go in and get a physical, and I guess it's well, they have people to talk to you. You don't know whether they're medical people or not. They just ask you, know, how'd you do, and this and that. They want to make sure that you're sane enough to go home. Well, we got on a bus, I did, and we went home. I went down to Lynchburg. They gave us a 30-day
What was the homecoming like?
Well, they hadn't seen me for a couple of years, and I remember getting off of the train down on Commerce Street and taking the taxi cab because my B-4 bag was loaded with stuff. And I got the taxi driver to put me here 2 blocks from home. Bad mistake to drag the suitcase. And I called my mother. I wrote to my mother after I got back to the States. I sent her a telegram. And when they saw me coming down the street, my mother was living at that time with an old maid aunt of mine, and they were living down on Clay Street in Lynchburg there. And I don't think she recognized me, to tell you the truth. She'd never seen me in uniform. The minute I left home, I was out of there. I was gone. And they sent me as far away from home as they could send me, from Virginia to Fresno, California, back up to Madison, Wisconsin, back out to Washington State. You know, it's that type of thing. Yeah, if you can get home and back in 3 days, you know, you're all right. Nobody had money to fly, not on $21 a month, or whatever it was we got.
So when you saw it, I'm picturing Norman Rockwell moment, you know, Maude, son, you know, it was a nice reunion.
Yes, it was, because a lot of people, I mean, they knew that I'd been over there, and I had made the newspaper some. They have these guys that come around and interview you, you know, and maybe somehow get you to say things that might make you into a hero or something that they could print about you. Fortunately, what they printed about most of us was true, I think.
Because wasn't there some aspect, you were the first complete crew to finish 20?
I didn't know this, but McAfee and I were in the museum. Have you ever been to the museum? Okay, you know where the B-17 is out there? Right in front of the nose of that B-17 is a little plaque about that size. They've got dozens and dozens of them. Rows. Down here, about second from the left-hand side in the second row, there's one. Mac and I were standing there, and he was reading it. J.G. McAfee, first crew to finish 25 missions intact.
What'd you say to each other when you...
I said, why don't you tell us? He said, I didn't know it myself, you know. Mac was the type of guy, though, that he was such a steady type guy. Nothing fazed him, you know, like glory. He wasn't there for anything like that. He had a terrible time with women. Is this going, how far is this going? I don't want this to hit. But Mac's dead, man. And of course, his wife, I guess, has moved back to Utah. But she was living over here in Tennessee. But I didn't know that. And you know, if I mentioned that to the guys in the group, they said, you're full of mud, you know. I know this, I know that. I said, well, if we could go out there and I could show it to them. And they don't print this stuff. It's on a brass plaque, you know. And I quit saying it, you know. And if they happen to read it, fine. If they don't, it's okay.
You touched on this earlier when we were talking, but at that point, once you got home and settled in, did you consider staying in the service?
No.
You were pretty set. You wanted to get on with your life. And
yes, you know, there's a difference, Ray, I think, in being told what to do and being told what to do all the time, you know, and where to go and when to go and when to come back. And, you know, you have to have a sense of freedom of something, you know. That's not, but the military right now is not anywhere near what it was back then, you know. The people live at home or live in somewhere else, you know, or live in almost luxury compared to what we were living in.
So how long was it then before you were discharged?
Well, I went back from there. I went to Langley Field. You know, that's another thing. We went to Miami after that. I went to Miami after about 30 days to a dispersal area. And they were taking these guys that lived in Virginia, North Carolina, and all of these places and sending them to California, New Mexico, Washington State. I live in Lynchburg. Langley Field is down the road a piece. And man, they never forgave me for that because I was lucky enough to get transferred to Langley Field. And I could go home on a 50-mile radius pass. Of course, it was almost 200 miles, but who's going to question you? And that went on. I was looking after radio equipment in Langley Field. They didn't have much to do there.
And so at some point along the way, you were discharged or get out of the service?
Yeah, they found, well, most of us did. They gave us an option. As I said, the guys came around and wanted to know if we wanted to go to the Pacific and get on the B-29 crew because we had some experience. Because the radio equipment by that time had been upgraded. They would probably have to send me to school to catch up with what I didn't know about those radios. Anyhow, all's well that ends well. I went down to a school and I took what they called at that time a high school progress test because I hadn't finished. And I got a little piece of paper that said it was equivalency to a high school education. Then I went to business school for a couple of years. And not long after that, I met this one. And she wasn't too shabby either, I'll tell you.
with the understanding she's sitting within striking distance, what attracted you first when you saw her?
Well, you didn't see her back then. As I said, she wasn't too shabby. And we had absolutely nothing. Well, we managed to raise 4 children. Moved to Florida. Well, I went to work in the Postal Service and worked for 28 years with my military time.
And how many years have you been married now?
112.
When you think back on your time in service, were you proud of your time in service?
Yes, I was.
And tell me why.
I guess, Ray, that I'm proud because I had achieved something by the skin of my teeth, of course. I want to qualify that a little bit because it's only by the grace of the Lord that we survived. And you get to wondering, how in the world did we get through that? No, it's just a miracle.